This is a quick video guide to working with custom connectors. I recently had to make a custom connector for my Raspberry Pi, which has a bank of male headers. I looked at a few different options and in the end I decided I'd invest in the tools to create my own custom cables. While the experiences are still fresh in my mind, I decided I'd make this video in case it would be of benefit as an introductory guide to others who are trying to do the same sort of thing. The first thing that you have to note is the spacing between the pins on the Raspberry Pi P1 header. It's a standard spacing size of 0.1 inches, which is 2.54 millimeters metric. That's good news as this is a very common spacing. There are other spacing sizes, for example, here's a 0.05 inch or 1.27 millimeter spacing connector, so be careful when you're picking a cable connector. It's also worth noting that the 0.1 inch spacing is useful for prototyping as it's consistent with most prototyping breadboards. So the first option I tried was a simple ribbon cable. This one is a 2x13, so it's 26 lines. It's a 6-inch in length cable that costs about $3 from SparkFun and it fits perfectly onto the Pi. I checked some local suppliers and a cable with two rows of 13 pins is fairly rare, so the SparkFun option is a good one. The only issue with this is that if you want to break out to a few different circuits, it isn't too easy. Also, if you only need half the connectors, it's somewhat wasteful. The cable is color keyed for polarity and you should probably align the red side with pin 1 so that you're consistent with the pin numbers. There is polarization on the plastic connector through the use of a plastic notch, which would allow you to use a polarized receptacle to ensure that the cable goes in the right way around. However, the Pi does not have this form, so you just have to be careful. My main issue with this solution is that if I need to break out a cable to multiple directions, and it may be the case that I have to use a few random pins. Also, I don't like being tied into a fixed length, so what I have gone for instead is a custom solution. The best solution I could come up with uses male and female crimp pins with crimp connector housings. The names of the items are not consistent for all suppliers, but the solution that I like best came from pololu.com. The parts are usually in catalogs under the heading titled PCB interconnectors with a 0.1 inch spacing. There are effectively two options available. One option is to use pre-crimped cables like these. A bag of 50 6-inch female to female multicolor cables costs around $10, and that's for 6-inch cables, 6-inch in length. The second part you need are the crimp connector housings. These are sold in sizes from as small as 1x1, which is just a single connector, up to larger forms like 10x1 and 12x2 and so on. And they are not that expensive, relatively speaking. For a bag of 25 of the 1-pin housings, it costs about 59 cents, and 5 of the 2x16 connectors costs about $2.50. Pololu.com was the cheapest place I could find the pre-crimped cables and housings, and they're of a very good quality. But if you know of a cheaper location, you can leave a message at the end of this video. The cables click neatly into the housings and it's a very easy solution to create your own custom cables. You can get female-female, male-male or male-female pre-crimped cables, which is very handy. It's also not bad value at $10, as with 56-inch cables you would need 100 crimps and that would cost about $6. So it's about $4 for the cable and the time spent crimping, which isn't too bad. The only downside is that you're constrained with fixed length cables, as they're available in 3-inch, 6-inch, and then it goes up to 1-foot and 2-foot. And they have greater sizes, but it might not be neat enough for your project. There is one other advantage of this cable configuration in general. It's fairly recyclable. If you need a new cable form, it is possible to carefully use a tweezers or a small screwdriver to lift the black plastic housing tag on the crimp connector housing, which allows you to remove the crimped wire from the housing. You then have the option to reuse the crimped wire, and if you're very careful, you can also use the housing in your next project. The second option is to crimp your own cables. While this is fairly labor intensive, it does give you the flexibility to use any length of cable. The other key advantage is that it allows you to crimp the ends of cables where there is already something attached. For example, if you had something like a stepper motor, it's very useful to be able to attach connectors to the end of the cables, rather than trying to solder on male headers onto the cables, which I've done before. You also get to choose whether you're adding male or female or mixed ends to your cables. So how does it work? Well, I've seen videos on how you can crimp the cable using a needlenose pliers and a lot of very careful manipulation. I went for the easy option though and bought a crimp tool. They can be incredibly expensive tools for what they are. On my searches, I found them for over $300, but the cheapest one I could find was on pololu.com for about $35. It works with 16 to 28 AWG wires, which is a pretty good range, and so far I am very pleased with it. It feels like a very good quality device, and I'm getting very consistent crimp connections. So what do you need? Well, ideally you need stranded cable rather than single core cable, as this works best with the crimp pins. 22 AWG stranded cable is working very well for me. You then need either female crimp pins for 0.1 inch housings, they're usually sold in 100s, or male crimp pins for 0.1 inch housings, again these are sold in 100s. Finally, you need crimp connector housings. I have tried a few different methods for crimping. You can place the connector in the tool before you slide in the cable, but I have found it very difficult to get the cable length in the crimp connect when you're crimping blind. First of all, you have to strip a very small amount from the cable using a wire strippers. I take off about an eighth of an inch, or about 3 millimeters. I'm just using a low-cost wire stripper for that. What I like to do is to place the cable at the correct position in the crimp before I place it in the tool. This is important because if you place the cable too far into the female connector, the male header on the pie won't fit into the female crimp housing, so you have to get this length correct. You can pinch the sides of the crimp connector slightly with a tweezers when the cable is in the crimp connector, and this can help hold smaller AWG wires in place. I'm right-handed, so holding the crimp tool with the fixed handle of the crimp tool at the top, so it's the right way up, I carefully sit the cable with the crimp on the end on the bottom teat of the tool using my left hand, making sure that the crimp on the left side is level with the teat. Then I gently ratchet down the tool, giving it a very firm press at the end to ensure that I get a very good contact. You can see here on the right side of the tool that the female housing part of the crimp connector should be fully visible and should not be crushed by the teat, otherwise the cable will not work in the housing. It's a little bit more difficult to do this holding it at a distance under the camera lens and trying to keep it in focus, but holding the crimp tool close up, I'm finding that it's very easy to get consistent crimps. You can see here what a consistent crimp should look like. The insulation and wire conductor should be visible at the top of the insulation barrel. The wire barrel should be closed and all of the wire strands should be inside it. And the wire strand shouldn't go very far beyond the wire barrel, and you should see a slight bell mouth on the wire barrel. Try not to warp the crimp when you're pressing down, it's easy to bend the connector. I've found the need sometimes to get an easy fit into the housing to pinch the wire end of the crimp with a tweezers or a small pliers to get a very smooth fit into the connector housing. You can see here the cable slides reasonably easily into the connector housing, and then you hear a small click when it is fully home. The connector will then sit very well onto the Raspberry Pi board male headers, and I found that you get a very firm fit that doesn't slide off easily. You can then go mad and create whatever type of connectors you want. Here's an example of a crimp connector added to the ends of a stepper motor. You can see that I've used the male crimp pins and the same crimp housings as you would for the female crimp pins. This is much easier than the solution I used before, which was to solder on the pins and then use a heat shrink tubing to keep them apart. It's also a much better connection that is less likely to short. Here I am using a 1x4 housing, and it works perfectly with standard breadboard spacing, giving a very stable connection. I'm using the male pins in this case. I can see that adding connectors to the end of sensors and devices such as motors will be my main use of this tool. Anyway, I hope that you find this useful. As I said, it took me a few hours to work out what I needed and what is available. It also took me a while to get used to crimping cables, so hopefully this video will save you some time. Please comment if you have any advice on other solutions to this problem, and if you have a cheaper supplier or better options for the parts, I will list them in the video description.